أسلم صلاة كاملة، أصلي صلاة تامة، وسيدنا ومولانا محمد الذي تنحل به الأقد، تنفرج به الكرب، وتنال به الرغائب، ويستصل غمام وجهه الكريم، وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وبعد. إنابة، بلوز تسليم، of Tahara. Don't look at your nose. Al-Wafa. Al-Dhir. تقوى العفو word of sabr is made of which letters, which huruf? And the word of Ihsan Kalimatul Ihsan is made of which letters? Two more words to go. Which are those words? I have to start depending on pen and paper. They are not in here yet, I can see that. No, they are not your words. These 7 words are the words of which the whole book Quran is made above, comes in different ways, repeated different times. And each word, as we said, is made of 2 letters, so that makes up 14 huruf, 14 letters and 7 words. كلمات الله التامات, Allah's complete words. each word is like an exercise. What puts you through each word until you fulfill the word. Let's say al-afu al-adil, to fulfill the word of taqwa, you have to, God will test you through afu, which is to pardon, and adil, which is to be just, both, so that your heart is balanced. It's not only pardon and no justice without pardoning. So Allah will test you through situations of your life until you are able to fulfill. Once you are able to balance between pardoning and being just at the same time, then you have fulfilled the word of taqwa. So it goes on like that. Then he'll test you through another word again, and so forth. It's possible that you may spend your whole life just to work on one word, but that's fine. As long as you are able to fulfill one, what you have done, you have had a great achievement. So all the trials and the triumphs of the prophets is about these words. Allah put them through different kind of situations as an exercise for them to be able to fulfill His words. And then once they fulfill His words, then God appoints them as leaders, as vice gerents. Because God will not give His trust to somebody who is not well proven, well exercised. That's naturally that will be a waste. Well, you should know if you know that this has become part of your character. When something becomes part of your character, then you have achieved that thing. If at all times you exercise something, you do something, then you have achieved that. If sometimes you do it, sometimes you don't, then no, it's not part of your character. It's not fulfilled. Verse 124 of Surah Al-Baqarah. وإذ ابتلى إبراهيم ربه بكلمات فأتمهن. قال إني جاعلك للناس إماما قال ومن ذريتي قال لا ينال أهدي الظالمين. like that, Yusuf Ali. Sorry. I don't know anyhow. We see that this is called ibtila, means to sort of exercise, to test, to try. Ibtila Ibrahim Rabbuhu. So Abraham was tried and tested by his Lord. Two words. Until he completed them, he fulfilled them. Doesn't tell us which are those, whether it's all of them or some of them, we don't know that. Bikalmatin, and Abraham has fulfilled them. He stood the test, fulfilled the words. And then God said to him, now I will appoint you as Imam for mankind. So when God said that to him, he said, and also of my descendants, God said, no. If they fulfill the words like you do, I'll appoint them too. But I don't appoint anyone who hasn't fulfilled. Zalimin means somebody who is short of what is fulfilling. So those who do not fulfill the words and do not entrust them with leadership, with khilafah. So being the case, Islam does not necessarily endorse succession through lineage, unless what the father accomplished, also the child accomplishes. There's no automatic succession. According to this verse, إِنِّي جَعِنَا خَالَ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي قَالَ لَا يَنَالُ أَهْدِي الظَّالِمِينَ. Ibrahim was not the first one. There are many prophets and messengers before him, beginning with Adam himself. Adam was a prophet and a messenger too. He was much late, and after him also came successive prophets. Yeah, naturally, I mean, if God put some trials on you, and you show your willingness in taking the challenge, then naturally God will help you through them. But you also have to prove that you stand up to the challenge, that you don't run away, you don't despair. You try and then try and then try, hoping that one day God will help you make it through. Then God, inshallah, at the end will help you triumph and succeed in fulfilling the word. Because he's the nearer father. They are both our fathers, but this one is nearer than the other one. So that's why we mention the nearest. So always the father that is closer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Ibrahim, because he came from Ibrahim directly, even though he came from Adam, but directly he came down from Ibrahim, which also goes back to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. Actually, most of us, we don't know. We know we come from Adam, but we don't know our lineage. We cannot count it to Adam. But you can count it to some of your father, your immediate fathers, like maybe fathers from 10 generations and so forth. So that's why. Again, coming to this, your good question, which is getting the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to attain your goals and your objectives. Because that's what we said, Iyyaka na'budu wa Iyyaka nasta'in. Because we're talking about this is all being a true slave of God. By fulfilling this word, you fulfill your slavehood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's Iyyaka na'bud, that's the goal. Iyyaka nasta'in is the means. We seek help from you to worship you. Because you can't worship God truly unless God helps you. As far as how to seek help from God to attain your objectives, God tells us what to do with that. So Iyyaka na'bud, Iyyaka nasta'in, God says elsewhere, Ista'inu بالصبر والصلاة. استعينوا بالصبر والصلاة. Two places in Surah Al-Baqarah. One in verse 45 of Baqarah. واستعينوا بالصبر والصلاة وإنها لكبيرة إلا على الخاشعين. واستعينوا بالصبر والصلاة وإنها لكبيرة إلا على الخاشعين. ألم So the be here will be translated better as true. Seek help through salah and sabr, steadfastness. So the width is through. Seek help through patience and prayer. Without these two, then you cannot succeed. and only God will help you through this. God says that you are constant in your prayer. But constance in your prayer means that you have hope. You haven't lost hope. Prayer is only hard for those who have lost hope. They don't pray. Those who have maintained their hope, they are steadfast. And you mentioned sabr, because, I mean, anything that you do consistently, you have to have patience. Of course, patience goes with everything. You saw how I put the patience before prayer. Only if you are steadfast and patient, then you can maintain your prayer. So patience is a means to maintaining the prayer, which is a means to being close to God, which is the objective, and being and truly serve Him as He deserves you to serve Him, and for which purpose He created you. So in other words, fulfilling the purpose for which you are created. So this is the means of getting to fulfilling, attaining to that purpose. So it's very important in anything. It goes with everything. Yes. Without that, you don't succeed. No. Again, same verse is repeated again in verse 153. Baqarah again. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu usta'inu bis sabri was salati inna allaha ma'as sabirin. What prayer we haven't we have discussed it many times is generally is, as you can see, is consists of remembrance of God. That's the purpose of prayer. Zikrullah, to remember God. That remembrance translates into different forms of worship. Supplication is prayer. Sometimes the word dua and salam are interchangeable. To ask God and to be constant in asking until you get what you ask Him for. That's also that's a prayer. Sometimes the word prayer means dua, asking God. And be constant, because those who, if you ask, you don't get, don't give up. Keep on asking until you get what you want from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then ista'inu bis sabri was salah inna Allah ma'as sabirin. And that is, Allah is with those
our visions, unless with them. Now, well, you know what you need. Nobody knows that. Whatever you need, that's good for you. Yes. Ask him for that. Yeah. Asking for that is not bad. If you're asking it for a good reason. Yeah. And then God will decide what if it is good for you or not. Then that is on grass with God, not doesn't lie with you. If you ask God, as he said, asking is worship, just the fact of asking. You are worshiping God by asking. Whether you get what you ask for or not, you have worshiped God anyway by asking. Getting it or not getting it is a different story. That is not your part. God decides whether it's good for you or not. So generally, if you ask for something which doesn't include anything that is bad in it, like asking something bad about somebody or something, then normally your supplication is answered. But it's answered in three ways. Either God gives you exactly what you ask for, or God doesn't give you what you ask for, but he keeps that thing for you, for your life hereafter. Or that supplication, he keeps it and block off some harm that is going to come to you later on. Okay. So in any case, asking whether you get what you ask for or not, just keep on asking. You don't know when, inshallah, that will benefit you. Maybe here or hereafter, or maybe it will be used to counter a harmful destiny that's going to fall on you in a later time. Taking Ibrahim as an example, and we see how, of course, how steadfast he was in asking God. Which is a sign of somebody who is patient and steadfast. So when he fulfilled the words of God and God appointed him as a leader, it was after that God then asked him to build Kaaba, and that's the beginning of, after all that, then he began that assuming his khilafah and doing the works of God. So for example, the word of Tawbah, let's see how Sayyidina Ibrahim fulfilled that. That's one of the examples. The story came any place in the Quran, but the one that is in Surah Safat about Sayyidina Ibrahim and his son.
we've seen how many trials God put him through. One of them is when they threw him in the fire. That's one of the trials. And they wanted him to give up his faith in the face of, and they threatened him with death penalty. And he did not give up his faith. So naturally, God tested his iman, and he passed that. They threw him in the fire, and fire did not burn him. And after that trial, he migrated from his country, leaving your native land also is another trial. If it is especially if it is for the sake of God, you migrated for the sake of practicing your religion better, in a better place, in a different environment. So his migration was not for the sake of just migrate for better, as they say, better opportunities. It was for better opportunities to practice his deen. So he left everything that he has, his land, his family, everything, to migrate. That's another test. Naturally, God will test you. So finally, when he migrated to the area of Sham, and eventually he has a family, after in old age, then another test came again. So this time the test is Allah wanted to see whether he loves Allah more than his child. Does all God wants you to prove that you love him more than anything else. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. Those who believe are those who love God the most. So as time goes by, God will test that love for him in different situations to see that you have maintained love of God above everything. So this time is he has, because God tested him through the very good, he loved God more than his homeland. He has proven that. Whether he loves God more than his life, he's proven that. But sometimes love of children is above all of this. That you sacrifice your own life for your children. You mean you love your children more than your own self. But this is another bigger test than the other test, actually. Love of homeland. It's another love that is very hard for people to part with, to give up their homeland and migrate in the word of God. So test after test, it was his past, then he came to this one. It's a test for you. That means the meaning that is test for you, God tests you through them. That's what it means. It's not in a negative connotation that they are a fitna for you, as you know. It means that they are given to you so that you may be tested through them. Because God tests you through his blessings. One of those blessings is your wealth and your children and your spouses. So through them God will test you. If you don't have them, then you have no test. That's why some prefer not to have them. They remain single and they have no money. They just
That's also another option. And if you have them, then you have to be tested for sure. That's the price. So now God is testing him through his child. So we see how he passed this test also. Yes, most of them. This is part of their exercise that leads them to their final station that God gives them. So they migrate from their homeland. They are, of course, expelled. They migrate. They go somewhere else. Yeah. So they abandon everything for the sake of God. One of the tests. That God places on them. Yeah. So Muslims from Mecca migrated to Medina. Yeah. That's why. One of their tests. So, قال رب هب لي من الصالحين. So he not lose hope, even though he's advanced in age, that God may still give him a child. That's another. The fact that he still maintains hope, it's a sign that he has. He's very patient in prayer. فبشرناه بغلام حليم. Then this is Safad from verse 100. But at the point when, because love of a child also become even stronger, is when they are about to grow. They are entering adulthood. Then when they die in childhood, it's less difficult on the parent than when they have attained certain age. So it's at that age that God tested him. فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعَهُ السَّعْيَ قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى قَالَ يَا أَبَتِ افْعَلْ مَا تُؤْمَرُ سَتَجِدْنِي إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الصَّابِرِينَ فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَ وَتَلَّهُ الْجَبِينُ وَنَادَيْنَاهُ أَنْ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ قَدْ صَدَّقْتَ الرُّؤْيَا إن هذا لهو البلاء المبين وفديناه بذبح عظيم وتركنا عليه في الآخرين سلام على إبراهيم كذلك نجزي المحسنين. So we see many words have already come in this. Ihsan came there, Sabr came there, Tawbah came, because Taslim is mentioned explicitly, and Inab is mentioned implicitly. We'll have to find that out. So all this came in this context. He made Tawbah, he proved Ihsan, he proved that he's patient.
سلام على إبراهيم كذلك نجزي المحسنين إنه من عبادنا المؤمنين عبادنا المؤمنين أعلم. Yes, 111.
Okay. So we see that Abraham did not, he was through various trials and exercises that he came to fulfill the word of God and for God to appoint him and trust him with the trust, the amana, the big trust. And God, as you say, God is wise. He will not, through his wisdom, he will not put his trust in a hand that cannot maintain it and hold it. So before he gave his trust to somebody, and the trust goes to the children of Adam, so God time and time will appoint some of them and give them the trust. But before he gives them, he will first let them pass through a number of exercises and trials until they have fulfilled a word or words, and then he'll give them the trust, which is, as he said here, is imama or khilafa or and so forth. We see here that the word that Sayyidina Ismail, the son, was already described as Halim. That's why we have Hilm. And later on described as he I'll be among those who have Sabr. So the word Ilm is implicit, because the word Sabr is at the end. Among those who are patient and steadfast. And Halim, somebody who is forbearing and magnanimous. So magnanimity plus knowledge is equal to patience. And the word taslim, falamma aslama, when they both submitted, which is verse 103. So submission is mentioned, surrendering to the will of God. But the other side is not mentioning explicitly, which is inaba. But implicitly, I mean, it's within, it's understood as part of the verse. See that verse 99, he says, قَالَ إِنِّي ذَاهِبٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي سَيَهْدِينِ. I'm going to my Lord, and he will guide me. Going back to God. I'm going to my Lord, and he will guide me. That constitute inaba. Inaba means to go back. And at the same time, it of course includes the meaning of hijra, because that's the time that he migrated from that place, in the sense that he returned back to God. Anabu ila Allahi lahum bushra. So inaba is at the beginning there, and we have taslim. In verse 99 is inaba, and verse 103 there is taslim, that makes up tawbah. So by analyzing the story of the Prophet, you can see how he fulfilled this word. So similarly, it goes through the stories of different prophets.
and the hurdles that they overcame in their life.
مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله كمثل حبة أنبتت سبع سنابل في كل سنبلة 100 حبة الله يضاعف لمن يشاء والله واسع عليم. This similitude that God we have here, what does it represent? What do you think? What kind of similitude God is setting forth here in this verse? What is the whole thing mean? What is it referring to? The LS is an example. What is the example representing? That those who spend their wealth in this life, a seed, okay, and that seed give 7 tassels, for example. Each tassel contains 100 seeds, true. So from 1 seed to 700, let's say, 700 still can multiply to more, if you can see that. What is the, this is growth and expansion, of course. What does it represent, this? What is, it's an example God is setting. That's a good start, but what? When does that get established? When do you give that measure? How do you give that measure? Now? What is the quality? When does that quality come from? The quality of beyond measure. But we do because you do things for God to do things for you. You do that. Okay. Now that's fine, but taqwa is one of the branches of this, one of the tassels of this plant. Well, the seed itself we're talking about, that's the root of all this. What is that? Well, taqwa is one of the tassels too. It's one of the seed that it bears. Anything that is here is a branch. Now, and what quality in Iman? That's the closest. What is in Iman? It's love, yeah. These are the fruit that it bears. But the seed that from which all these fruits come. Only that. Love of those who love God too. Same. That's part of loving God. You will see. Hubbu. Ali Habba. Look at them. They come from the same root. Imagine the smallest entity that exists, the smallest when the belief in God goes down to the smallest essence, the true essence of the human being, then the love of God grows from there. It has to sink down to the innermost part of your being or yourself.
الذين آمنوا أشد حبا لله. So when the iman, the raindrop of iman falls on that grain, that's the innermost part of yourself, when the iman drops on that as a drop of rain, then that growth begins. Then it grows, like I said, grows and grows, and then begins to develop all these branches. But without that, none of this can come. Iman, alladhina amanu wa shaddu hubba. Love of God developed from that iman. It's kind of, well, we can look at saying that once your iman is truly from the core, has reached the core of yourself, then the love of God begins from there, in which case you don't calculate with God anymore. Because iman has different level. If your iman is not in there, but it's just somewhere in your mind, which also happens, if your belief is not ingrained in the very essence of yourself, but somewhere in your mind, your conscious, whatever level of consciousness, then that iman does not go without calculation. And also there's a possibility of losing it too, because it's not too deep. You can get uprooted. Permeate, yes. Has to sink down very to the very, very core. The core. Then your growth begins. From that core, the expansion begins. Surah 2. Al-Hujurat. Verse 7.
وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ لَوْ يُطِيعُكُمْ فِي كَثِيرٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْرِ لَعَنِتُّمْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَّ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانَ وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ وكره إليكم الكفر والفسوق والعصيان أولئك هم الراشدون فضلا من الله ونعمة والله عليم حكيم.
Adam 7 and 8.
Thank you.
born. The birth of Iman. So still going with the word Habbaba. Habbaba. So Habbaba. Another word in Arabic called Hubab. What is that?
No?
لا حباب. حباب. No. You have a question again. You have a question? Sure, yeah.
I will say, were you open to having it? You have to have the willingness to receive it too. It comes down, but if you are open to it, it comes into you. No? It's like if your heart is repels the water, it's like you have rocky land, you have, you know, fertile land. Rain comes on both sides, on everybody. See, that rain is the rain of Iman. But there are some soil that accept the rain and give the crops in abundance. Some reject the rain completely. Some accept the rain, but do not grow anything. So there's a beautiful verse in hadith in Bukhari about that. Different kinds of people who receive the guidance that comes from God. Rasulullah said, like, what I have brought, guidance and knowledge, is like a rain came down. One land is fertile, one land is rocky, but is able to hold the rainwater. So it's not able to grow anything, but it holds water, so people can come and fetch the water and go and water the fertile land. There are some lands that do not hold water, do not also grow anything, so they reject the water completely. So hubab means wave or bubble. Wave or bubble? Wave. Habab or habab. Sometimes they use the word habab. This is fusha. Habab. This is singular habab, and habab is plural. So all this carry the image of hub. Allah is saying how he drives love home, or how he drives Iman home into the hearts. And they use the word faid, which is the same idea. Faid from Allah means faid. Father Faid, same idea. Father. Al-Fayd, the same thing. Means the water to flow. So Habbab ilaykum al-Iman. You drove Iman right into the core, the very dark spot in your heart.
iman, drop of iman, touch that spot. Then you get the real taste of iman now. Haddada ilaykum iman. So iman comes like a ripple, a wave of water. So you put iman, and also the ornamentation of iman, something that makes iman look beautiful and attractive. But that attraction is internal. It attracts your attention to look inwardly. The outer life, it has its attractions. The inner life also has its attractions. So the inner life, that's what iman represents. So that the zenith that is inside. Look inside, you see the glory and the beauty of the inner life and the unseen, the malakut. So once the iman touches that most sensitive spot for heart, then the love of God grows from that point. And a love that nothing can shake, even if they cut you into many pieces, you cannot give it up. Let's see what happened. This is only, let's go to Surah Yusuf, and we see the illustration of what happens when this is only a human being, not a human, when the human being's love, another human being goes down to that spot, it's unshakable. What about if it is a love of Allah's mother?
قال نسوة في المدينة امرأة العزيز تراود فتاها عن نفسه قد شغفها حبا إنا لنراها في ضلال مبين.
حبا شغفها, شغف, شغاف.
Verse 30. قد شغفها, شغف حبا,
يقول شغاف, شغاف القلب.
That has not reached right into your heart, when you are dying, it leaves you. Only something that has settled in your heart, that dead doesn't go. So all that you know in your mind goes. Everything leaves at dead. Except things that have
entered your heart. That doesn't die when you die. So if your faith has attained to your heart, then you die with your faith, you die believing. If your faith doesn't attain your heart, then you don't die with faith. No. Same with knowledge. Any knowledge that has not reached into your heart, that knowledge, you don't die with it. And death comes, it also goes. You die, they die too. If it is in your heart, you don't die. You live on.
إذن قال نسوة في وقال نسوة في المدينة امرأة العزيز تراود فتاها عن نفسه قد شغفها حبا إنا لنراها في ضلال مبين. شغفها شغاف يس ألم
and gossip, huh? That's not like what? That's a good translating.
So the word shagafaha shigaf means the spot. So what the expression here they are saying is that the love of Sayyidina Yusuf has gone down to that very spot in her heart. This was Allah said. So, Habbaba ilaykum al-Iman, Allah has drove Iman right into that very spot in your heart. Iman has said. Then, Uzayyanaha fi qulubikum, after he put Iman right there, then he adorned it, also still within, not without, lest you look out outwardly, but so that you can look inwardly and contemplate on the beauty of the inner world, in the kingdom of God. So the heart is like a door. Your heart, it opens up to the inner universe, if you call Malakut. If you can't see through your heart, then you can't see the Malakut, because you can't see it outright. But the door is within yourself. You have to learn to look within your own heart till you know how to see through your heart. Now, at this point is a crime, because his high intention was not right. It was not, she didn't love him for the love of God. Then it's okay. At this point is a crime. That's why I said that is part of why you marry somebody. You marry him because of his because he loves God, so God. So you call religion, religion is love. You call deen, we have maybe been love. That's what deen truly is. That's what deen is. Yeah, but this love can be between many, many things. Human being can come to that love until this love is seeps through into their heart. Now let's see an example of that also. I'm just trying to say, I'm giving it of how, where love has to go of God. It has to sink down deep into that core, shiraf. Yeah, no, I'm not. I didn't cut it for that example. That's a different aspect of the story. I'm just saying that how deep and strong her love was for him with all the challenges. See, but that love changed. Which is good. It changed into a good love. This is the thing. Still, the same love changed. The intention changed with it. No, at this point, no. Yes. Has to change. Yes, intention. So it changed into a good love. Yeah. Yeah, anyway, that's what it is. Yes. Yeah. That's what I was trying to illustrate. Let's go back to Baqarah. Just trying to illustrate this watery quality of love that it seeps through until it settles down in the heart. Yeah. Verse 93 of Baqarah. وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَكُمْ وَرَفَعْنَا فَوْقَكُمُ الطُّورَ خُذُوا مَا آتَيْنَاكُمْ بِقُوَّةٍ وَاسْمَعُوا قَالُوا سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا وَأُشْرِبُوا فِي قُلُوبِهِمُ الْعِجْلَ بِكُفْرِهِمْ قُلْ بِئْسَ مَا يَأْمُرُكُمْ بِهِ إِيمَانُكُمْ إِن كُنتُم مُّؤْمِنِينَ. And three. وشربوا في قلوبهم الإجل. Now.
Remember when you say making the mountains horrible and say, hold on for me what we have given you, and this is what we have done. Is it easier as we saw? And who did you say they were meant to bring the love of the God deep into their hearts?
It's
not completed. It didn't finish completely. It didn't finish the whole thing. Qul, say. No, no, the same verse is not. It didn't translate the whole thing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's not the end of the verse. Unless your Quran has divided the verse into two. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's good. Lovely. You see the image, Ushribu, they were made to drink. Although this love is something that they drank until it settled down in their heart. So that love is very unshakable. One has love as though you drink it. So when God's love has settled down into your heart, and you have a real taste the love of God, then that love keeps on growing. Each wave it goes, with each wave it goes, each wave comes, keeps on coming. The waves of love. That was what I was trying to illustrate. Now, so this is the love of the calf. You see how strong the love can be. Al-Ajl. Those who worship the calf among Moses, the followers, and the desert. Of course, it's a bad love. Yeah. But that love also is almost, you can't remove it. It's the same thing. Something comes like that way into the heart, then it's written. Yeah. Exactly. Because it doesn't go out. Exactly. Doesn't go out. So shribu fi qulubihim al-ajla. So hence iman is something that you acquire. You can teach people how to be open to iman until it comes down into their heart, settles down. Yes. No, that doesn't happen like that. No. Have to work on it very, very hard.
Suratul Ankabut.
Verse 2 and 3. حسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون ولقد فتنا الذين من قبلهم فلا يعلمن الله الذين صدقوا ولا يعلمن الكاذبين. عنكبوت 2 and 3. Alam. So if sometimes it may happen that the love may be mixed with something else, so that has to be, God will have to put the person through many tests to remove that that taint from it until it becomes very pure. Like if the haqq and the true love and the false love are mixed. Before you die, God will have to put you through test to sublimate the love. The same way, if you put the iron ore or the gold or the silver in the fire so that to remove all the dross and the rust from it until it becomes just silver or just gold, nothing else. If it happens that the love of God is like that, then you have to go through that intense heat of fire and test until all the dross, all the rust fall off and the pure essence remains. So that what happened to the wife of the Aziz in the surah. He loves her now, but that for God and for also personal love of lust and love of God, lust of Iman and love of God. These are two kinds of love. Love of Iman and love of lust. So it was mixed at the beginning and that became pure at the end. The love of lust was removed and only love of Iman left. Pure and untainted. Called Hubul Iman and Hubul Shahwat. So if the Hubul Iman and Hubul Shahwat are mixed, then it's tainted love. It's not pure. And the Hubul Shahwat will, Allah will remove that. That's lust until only love of faith and belief remains. So you love somebody for the sake of belief and faith, not for lust.
Mm-hmm.
go back to Surah Yusuf. Mercy from God that God's love is very strong, but just a tiny drop of it can kill some human being, you know. So he makes sure that it comes in small waves, you know, slowly. Because just look what the love of a human being said now Yusuf, because he's reflecting that divine beauty that he has, that God has covered him with, and how much that has impacted other human beings around him. And it's only a reflection of God's quality.
قال ما قد بكنا إذ راوتنا يوسف أن قلنا حاشا لله ما علمنا عليه من سوء الآن حصل الحق.
Class 51. وأرضوا عن نفسي وإنه لمن الصادقين. ذلك ليعلم أني لم أقل بالغيب وأن الله لا يهدي كيد الخائنين. Alam. That was the statement from the wife of the Aziz. Now the truth has become, that means hashasa, it became clear. Now it's not mixed with the falsehood anymore. That's our own statement. The truth was mixed before. But mixed truth and the falsehood. Now she realized that now hashasa al haq. Now she, her love, Sayyidina Yusuf, is the love of Iman, purely the true love. Go back to Surah An-Nisa, Surah Al-Imran, I think. That verse we discussed many times, but just have a look at it in this context. Verse 14 of زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهْوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ وَالْقَنَاطِيرِ الْمُقَنْطَرَةِ مِنَ الذَّهْبِ وَالْفِضَّةِ وَالْخَيْلِ الْمُسَوَّمَةِ وَالْأَنْعَامِ وَالْحَرْثِ ذَلِكَ مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَاللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ حُسْنُ الْمَآبِ.
14 of Ali Imran. Alam?
So mainly we talk about this in the case of Hubbu Shahwat, the love of lust. Mainly it's about the seven, talk about the seven branches. So from that seed, so if the love is, this love grows out of the seed of lust, that lust also multiplies into seven branches. One branch is lust for spouse, one branch is lust for children, the branch is lust for gold, lust for silver, lust for horses, maybe today's cars and so forth, things that to ride on, and lust for cattle, and lust for land. But these are generally the seven lusts that a human being has. But this lust has to be transformed into love of Iman. You can love these things, but from the point of view of Iman. Talking about two kinds of love. Love that proceeds from Iman. Love that is based on lust. That's what I'm saying. No. So I'm saying that the love of Iman is the love that is rooted in the love of God first, so that love of God is superior to anything that you, anything else that you love. And that God has to prove, we have to prove that
by your willingness to give up anything for the love of God, as we see in Sayyidina Ibrahim. And that begins with your spouse, your children, your gold, your silver, so that there is no more attachment for them in your heart. Because attachment is a sign of love, of a strong attachment, that you cannot transcend them. But if you have them, having and attaching is not the same thing. You can have something and own it and cherish it, but not being attached to it. Because if you have it and not attached, you are able to separate from it, no problem. If you are attached, then that means you can't separate from it. That is a sign that the love is competing with the love of God. I think anyway, there's all this, you can read them in detail in the expansion there. It's not in the one that is published already. This is another expansion. But they are all written about in detail. You can read further on them. That's good to know what kind of love is right, what kind of love is not right. That's part of love of Shahwa. It's part of these seven. Sometimes they say that love of those who remove, work on their heart, that remove all forms of love that are hindrance to love of God. The one that is most hardest to remove is the love of riyasa, of leadership and position, to lead your kind, your fellow human beings. The love is very strong. Sometimes it takes over the love of children and anything. Then people earn money, they are working hard money because they want to buy power with it. If you normally see that the drive for being wealthy, okay, is mainly to power. To have power and prestige. Tried as everybody else. Nobody is exempted from trials. That among many other things. Yes, of course. Actually, that's what it is, because the hadith says that they even force him to lead them. He doesn't say no. I don't want to lead you. I want to take any part of you. They force him. They literally take him, force him and bring him and give him bayah. He doesn't want. He doesn't jump up to be a leader, no. Nobody does that. He knows Allah and loves Allah too. Because he didn't look for it. Allah gives it to him because he's the only one who deserves it. He has qualified by then. That's why. Didn't have the love for it at all. So it's given them in that case, then it's fine. Yeah. So Mantalaba Riyasa, as the hadith says, the one who, if you seek leadership and position, then and you get it, then you are on your own. If leadership comes to you without seeking it, then Allah will appoint an angel to be with you, to help you. Mm-hmm. If you make mistakes, Allah will forgive you. There is no accountability with that, because He did not, it's given to you. If you take it, you are accountable for everything, mistake,
Your mistake is your mistakes. So that's the difference between the two. That's a big question. Because in human being is even to take care of your own self is so hard. Your own nafs. What about 10 nafs? Take care of 100 of souls, thousands. How can you do that? It's impossible unless Allah really helps you. And Allah will not help you if you take it on your own. If He gives to you, that's a different story. He'll help you. See? Sayyidina Umar, at the end of his khilafah, he said to Allah, my strength is weak now. My kingdom is too large. Allah cannot take me back to you. So before I started to, fail in my duty, before that, take me to you. Yes? He said that in Hajj, and that was the year he died. People think that they were enjoying it. It's not an enjoyment. It's a big pressure. To lead to take care of other souls. It's not easy. It's a big load. قول قولي هذا استغفر الله لنفسي ولكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله